Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, RV, whatever it may be. These are the absolute truest definition of professionals that you're ever going to find. Purdy Insurance. The best in the business. It's all at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we are in the Sunbury Motors Studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory, all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf online at sunburymotors.com. Oh, and by the way, that service department's outstanding. Inspections, routine, they take care of it all at Sunbury Motors. 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 to 15, Hummel's Wharf online at sunburymotors.com. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day.
Huntley takes the snap, rolls right, throws for the corner of the end zone. Knocked away. They were looking for Andrews at the pylon. Incomplete. The Packers are up one with 42 seconds remaining. And for the second time in as many weeks, dating back to Pittsburgh, Baltimore is left with a possible comeback.
Gerald Sandusky with the call on the Ravens radio network. Liked the idea he went for two. We're going to talk about this in analytics in a moment. Liked the idea he went for two to win it. Liked the idea he went for two against Pittsburgh. Okay, the play call against Pittsburgh I loved. I hated the play call. For one thing, they don't split out Mark Andrews that often. And the Packers, look, they rotated in his direction right off the snap. Number one, you got Adrian Amos covering him. And then Darnell Savage rotated over right away and was there. So I did not, when they lined up, I'm like, I don't like this play call at all. I think you just see that A, they wanted to go to Andrews. They made it too obvious. And B, they put him in a spot he's not normally at. Now, against Pittsburgh, just, you know, I know Watt got in there, and, you know, Watt made a nice play, but it was a lousy throw by Jackson, to be frank with you. So, now let's get to the analytics. And there was an article that was written by a guy named Joe Lucia. He does a good job. But like many young writers, he's very analytics-driven. Nothing wrong with that. It's part of the sports culture of today. Now, analytics have been around since, I mean, for decades and decades in sports. If Saquon Barkley carries the ball 20 times and gains 120 yards, he's averaging 6 yards a carry. Statistic, right? It's also analytics. Yeah. They go more in depth now with the numbers than they ever have. Far more in depth. And what I find interesting, I mean, let's say, you know, Chad goes to the plate 10 times, gets three hits, he's hitting 300. It's a stat. It's an analytic. It's the same thing. There's no difference. These are just more in-depth. All right? So Joe Lucia does a nice job. But sometimes you can be too targeted on what your interest is. So he writes, over the last several weeks, we've seen NFL head coaches make analytically correct decisions on fourth down and two-point conversion situations that didn't work out. The resulting conversations in the studio were not illuminating. Okay, fair. On Sunday, they were correct decisions on fourth down or whatever, I can debate that, which I'm going to get into. Okay? On Sunday, the NFL Today crew talked about John Harbaugh's decision to go for two down nine in the fourth quarter. He says it didn't go well. So then they posted Phil Sims.
I want to see the analytics people come up and do the interview after the game. Tell me why you did it. Let me hear that explanation. You know, it changes when you're down two scores. The other team, as you said, Bill, they change their play calling and how they direct the game. So we don't put that into the analytics, I don't think. I don't know. I don't care. We saw the Pittsburgh Steelers do the same thing against the Minnesota Vikings, and it kind of caught them. But the last thing, Cleveland's defense, they were all over the quarterback. They got four sacks, hitting the lot, so they made it tough. Once again, Myles Garrett, Jadeveon Clowney, like the first meeting they had, they played very well.
You know, but before we leave that point, I would love to see, that's a great idea, to have somebody who is in charge of the analytics, have that conversation afterwards to talk about the other aspects of the game.
No, here it is. Here's the whole thing. Well, analytics told me to do it. Yeah. All right, next question. Wow. That's what we see.
Yeah, they'll show you a spreadsheet and
there's
say,
never any explanation of why all decision. These things that can happen. So
paralysis by analysis, we overanalyze things. It's not that hard.
Yeah. See, that was on the NFL Today. So, of course, Sims gets criticized for this, okay? Says, that's not insightful. I'll get to that in a moment. They talk about the Steelers going for two against the Vikings. It backfired, of course, giving up a touchdown three players later to the Vikings and going down 16 was probably more damaging. Had they kicked the extra point, they would have been down 15. Would still need two touchdowns and a two-pointer. Pittsburgh did end up scoring, converting, and later in the quarter, but couldn't score again. Instead, they lost by 7, not 8. Harbaugh explained his decision succinctly in a post-game press conference, which came shortly after the discussion, seemingly fulfilling requests of Sims and James Brown for someone to explain themselves.
Really not a non-decision. You do it at that point in time. It's pretty much a standard kind of really not a non-decision. You do it at that point in time because you're going to have to win a two-point conversion. So you understand if you get it or don't get it early where you're at going from there, how many possessions you're going to need and what you're going to have to do. If you wait till the last two-point conversion and you don't get it, the game's over. You've lost. So you try it early. We're in a seven-point game. We know where we stand. We don't get it. We're in a nine-point game, and we know that we need two possessions.
Now, that wasn't yesterday. That was the nine-point deal. Okay? Where if he kicked the extra point, he's down 8. Going for two, he'd get to 7. You can make arguments on both sides of the map there. At some point, you'll need it. But you've got a guy in Justin Tucker who's a 99% guy. Now you need a touchdown and a two-point conversion. By missing the two-point conversion, now you're looking at the math, and guess what? You need two drives to do it. Thursday night's game between the Chiefs and the Chargers. The teams went for it 6 times on fourth down, 5 by the Chargers, converting twice. The conversions, both the conversations both in the Fox studio and in the booth were minimal. But it could be summed up as, I don't understand why they're being so aggressive. Take the points. Now, that assumes that Dustin Hopkins would have been able to easily nail a 45-yarder in the third quarter following a failed fourth and two conversion. Chargers' other two failures and the Chiefs' one failure came inside the 5-yard line, giving the opposition a long field if they couldn't punch it in, though one of those three was at the end of the half with time expiring on the final play of the drive. If you don't convert and the opposition drives up the field for a score, don't you have to pin some of the blame on the defense instead of analytics? Now we're starting to go in a circle here. How is it the fault of Brandon Staley's decision-making that the Chiefs went 95 yards and 11 plays in the first quarter? There's a lot to break down here because, I mean, it's just... I'm going to throw out two words that are really important. Common sense. No one gives a, and he uses an expletive as he writes here, testing the analytics when it works. Justin Herbert converted a fourth and one in the second quarter from the Chiefs 33, and the Chargers scored a touchdown a few plays later. A weird moment came in the fourth quarter when Josh Kelly converted a fourth and one to bring up a first and goal. On third down, Kelly fumbled, and for some reason the conversation shifted to complaining about leaving points on the board. Okay. This is obviously a person that just doesn't get the sport of football in any way, shape, or form. It had nothing to do about Kelly fumbling and leaving points on the board. It had to do with the fact that earlier in the game, when they could have kicked a couple of field goals, that fumble wouldn't have been as consequential. What are we even doing here, he writes. Oh, I don't know, Joe. We're analyzing your circling a fogged-in statistical airport. The discussions about analytics and decision-making in the NFL and most other sports broadcasts focus far too much on the results rather than the process. Obviously, this guy has no clue what our jobs are. I'd rather see coaches and players praised for making sound decisions that don't work. I just did that with John Harbaugh, didn't I? I believe I just did. I did the same thing in 1984 when I was doing this show back then, when Tom Osborne went for two and failed against Miami. And I said, I had so much respect for him doing that. He's trying to win it. I got it. All right. Instead of being scorned for stupid decisions that do work rather than tying reactions to outcomes. It has nothing to do with that. Okay? So let's break this down, because there's a lot about this that you can be so married to your theories that you lose sight of the big picture. For one thing, let's talk about this. You've got to have a real feel. And the best ones ever are the ones that have a feel for what they're seeing. Okay? And that goes into their decision making as to what to do next. So let's talk about the Chargers for a moment. The Chargers' opening drive, they drive down the field running the football with Austin Eckler. And then when they got down to about the five, and by the way, I'm somebody who thinks Justin Herbert's a really good quarterback, by the way. For the first time in the game, they throw it. All right, incomplete. So on second down and goal at the five, they threw it again. Incomplete. Third and goal at the five, they threw it again. Incomplete. Then the fourth down was the play that Parham got hurt on. I mean, he had him in the back, and he hit his head, and he got the concussion. The poor guy is, you know. But again, it was incomplete. So the question would be, you ran the ball down the field. Why didn't you run the ball one time from the five-yard line? Now I've had three misfires throwing the ball. I'm still at the five-yard line. At this point, you look around and say, you know what? I'm not wasting. Okay? I'd send Hopkins out there. I take the points. Now, if I'm in the third quarter and say I'm down 4 points, I may have a different decision to make based on what I'm seeing on the field. That's a... See, when coaches go into press conferences and they go, well, that's what the analytics says you should do, my question would be, what does common sense tell you to do? If that's your answer, you shouldn't be coaching. Because analytics tells you you should be going for it on every fourth down. Analytics tells you you should be going for 2 points on every touchdown. That's what analytics tells you. There's no common sense to that. No common sense. In fact, I've got the ball fourth down and one at my own 11-yard line with a 6-point lead. And 20 seconds left. What do I do? Analytics says it's fourth and one at the 11. I need to go for it. What do I do as the coach? I tell the snapper to put it on the money to my punter, and I tell my punter to run out of the back of the end zone for a safety. Now it's a 4-point game, and I'm getting a free kick from the 20. My decision's anti-analytics, but it's the right decision because it fits the moment. So let me tell you about one of the great analytics calls of all time. The analytics would love, they would never talk about this. Frozen field, down 3, fourth and goal at the 1. Kick a field goal, you go to overtime. And these are under the old overtime rules where the first team that scores would win in overtime. The coach decided to go for it, and his quarterback snuck it in from 1 yard out, and they won the game 21-17. The coach's name? Vince Lombardi. The quarterback, Bart Starr. It was 15 below zero. 15 below zero. Call timeout, the last timeout they had. Starr runs over. He says, I think I could sneak it in behind Bowman and Kramer. Lombardi said, he says, well, run it and let's get the hell out of here. Analytics would have loved him. I know I loved it. I thought it was an awesome play, awesome call. If he didn't make it, he didn't make it. Harbaugh, I'm all for him going for 2 points in each situation. The play call against Pittsburgh was really good. The one yesterday was not. I have more of a problem with the play call than the thought process. Just like I thought Tom Osborne, what he did going for two, was great. Penn State played Notre Dame, Beaver Stadium, wind chill was below zero. Base temperature was 15 degrees. Tony Rice and Notre Dame drove it down and scored to make it 21-20. They went for two to win it. Lou Holtz made the call. To this day, I thought it was a great call. Pete Kuykendall just made a better play. And Penn State won the game 21-20. When it doesn't work, it doesn't mean it's not a great call. So let's go back. Penn State, Big Ten championship game. Big Ten title game, Wisconsin. Down 21-7. They just fumbled. Conley had just scored. Down 21-7. Penn State added like fourth down and three or four about their own 42. And I'm thinking to myself, if I'm James, I go for it here. Got to change the direction of this game here. And he did go for it, and they didn't make it. And to this day, I'll defend it. I thought it was the right call based on the feel of the game in the building and what I was watching at the time. And yeah, Wisconsin took it at from there, and they went down and scored, took a 28-7 lead, but we all know Penn State came back and won. 38-31. And by the way, the final Wisconsin play was a fourth and one that they had to go for, and Penn State stopped it. The problem I have with analytics people, and it's a huge problem, is they deeply believe it's the only
way. And I'm here to tell them it is a way, and there are many different ways to win a game over 3 hours. Analytics people think it's the only way. And that's where being thoroughly and completely numerically naive and not having football sense, which is common sense, that's their downfall with their theories. There are certain times I say go for it on fourth down. You're darn right there is. There's times I say go for it for a two-point conversion. And there are other times where I'm looking at the math and I'm saying, okay, the math doesn't quite work here. We need to go a different route. I'm always talking about how many possessions are left in the game. I'm always talking about that in the fourth quarter. Right? Basketball, 8 minutes to go, 4 minutes to go. How many possessions, Dick, do you think are left in this game? I'll ask that question. Analytics can be very, very useful, but always remember analytics are a tool. They are not always the solution. You have to have a feel for the game and what you're seeing and how it's playing out to then aid your decision making as to what to do. You can't always go to a card and go, what do you think I should do here now? If you have to do that, wow. All right, back with more in a moment. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, RV, you name it, they'll take care of it. They'll update policies. They'll do everything they can to save you money. They'll get you the best price. They'll research it. They'll find it. They're the best in the business. It was so great to see Steve Engel and the gang last night. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Great to see Tom Mertz last night as well. Sunbury Motors. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai. Maybe the budget says pre-owned inventory. It's got the Sunbury Motors guarantee. Can't ask for better than that with pre-owned inventory. They have a wide selection of it. Sales staff that works with you are going to do everything they can to get you the best deal possible. Your trade-in's never been worth more. And the service department is just tremendous. Inspections, routine maintenance, you name it. They can take care of it. It's all at Sunbury Motors, one-stop shopping. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Yeah, so talking about analytics, again, they absolutely have a place. There's no getting around it. Analytics has a place in sports. It's how you use it. It's that additional tool. Does it get you to maybe think about a situation differently? Yeah, perfectly fine. But once the game starts, you've got to go by your gut feel and not by a card. You know, you got to sense what the situation is. Use your experience, okay? Not the experience of somebody that's putting together a card. You're the coaching professional, right? This is an aid to help you as a coaching professional. But at some point, it's your call, so you make the call. And again, it doesn't have to work. Like I said, you know, I go back to the 2016 Big Ten Championship game. It didn't work, but man, I agreed with it at the time. And I'm glad he did it. It didn't work. Tom Osborne's two-point conversion didn't work, but I agree with it.
John Harbaugh, last couple weeks, 2-point conversions to win it. I agree with it. So it doesn't mean I don't sit there and say analytics people are all wet. Don't do it. No. But my gut feeling in watching the game was that, you know what, it's the right call. Go for it now. And then there are times I'll look at it and say, you know what, you need to go for overtime here. It just depends on how you feel at the moment based on what you're seeing. And you have to be able to make football calls as to how football games are played, because the analytics will tell you you have to go for it on fourth down every time. They'll tell you you have to go for 2 points every single time. Okay? How many times, let's take a missed extra point. How many times have you seen a missed extra point hang over the game and hang over the game and hang over the game, and then you're thinking to yourself, okay, at what point do I chase points here? Okay, maybe I should avoid chasing points because you missed an extra point, right? Well, the odds of getting a 2-point conversion are higher than, of course, missing an extra point. So with the odds of missing it, yeah, you can get 2 points out of it, like the Patriots did against Buffalo. And that 2-point conversion on the opposite side hung over that game. It was 8-7. It was 11-10. That 2-point conversion kept hanging over the game. Then they made it 14-10, where now they needed a touchdown and couldn't get to overtime with a field goal. So there was a case where you went for two early in the game and then hung over the entire game. More often than not, though, it's the other way around. You feel like missing it hangs over the game. And do I chase points? So there's a lot that goes into it. It's not analytics tries to make the sport black and white on decisions. And it's not. Every game takes on its own personality. Every game is different. And I'm saying that from experience because I've done a lot of them and I know how different they all are. Okay? They are not homogenized where you do everything by what the book says. No. It's not how sports works. It doesn't mean there are times you sit there and go, you know what? I know analytics says we should go for it in fourth down. You know what my gut feeling is? I think they're absolutely right here. We should go for it right here. We need to. Because I'm looking at the situation. I'm looking at the clock, how many possessions. I'm looking at a lot of things. I kind of feel like we're up to almost last stand time now. Let's go. Because that's what the game is telling you. If you have the ability to read the game, to read the room... Okay, you don't need a card to tell you that. All right, Major League Baseball's antitrust exemption facing a new legal test today. Lawyers representing the parent companies of four former minor league teams, the Staten Island Yankees, the Tri-City Valley Cats, the Norwich Sea Unicorns, and the Salem Kaiser Volcanoes. Now, three of those four, Staten Island, Tri-City, Norwich, were all in the New York Penn League. Salem was in the Northwest League, filed a lawsuit in U.S. District Court alleging that Major League Baseball Commissioner's Office violated the Sherman Antitrust Act. Those four clubs had their affiliate status revoked as part of Major League Baseball's overhauling minor league baseball last year. That process saw 40 teams removed. The complaint filed by Weil, Gutschall, and Mangus. That sounds like a great law firm, Chad. I mean, have you heard the Suits law firm?
No.
Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe. What a group. It's fabulous. Hey, just one before I get back to this. You want to know what I picked last night as my gauge as to when to leave?
When there was dancing?
No.
Okay.
When the Suit had his eighth dessert. When number eight was delivered to the table, I said, that's it, I'm out of here. I even went to the table. I said, your eighth dessert? He goes, well, right, sure. I said, I'm gone. I couldn't take it anymore. And I love the people I was with, but seeing the eighth dessert, I'm sorry, one guy shouldn't have eight. They're small. Oh, boy. The complaint filed by Weil, Gutschall, and Mangus spans 33 pages. It states that Major League Baseball's reorganization of the minors was a naked horizontal agreement to cement Major League Baseball's dominance over all professional baseball. Major League Baseball, of course, received its antitrust exemption, which allows it to serve as a legalized monopoly in 1922 after it faced opposition from the Federal League. By the way, the remnants of the Federal League still live on, if you've ever seen a game at Wrigley Field. Wrigley Field was built for the Federal League team. It was not built for the Cubs. A piece of legislation that is supposed to prevent companies from fixing markets and thereby harming customers. Major League Baseball's antitrust exemption was granted on the grounds that the league doesn't constitute interstate commerce, a confusing claim given the very nature of baseball being interstate. Craig Calcaterra explained in 2019, organized baseball appealed, however, the direction was reversed when the Court of Appeals holding that baseball was not subject to the Sherman Act because it's not interstate commerce. The short version, a game is only played in one place. A game is local in its beginning and in its end. The Supreme Court has since stood by its ruling on other occasions, including relating to the Curt Flood case in 1972. Part of the Major League Baseball antitrust exemption was later removed in the 90s when then-President Bill Clinton signed the Curt Flood Act of 1998 into law. The Curt Flood Act removed only part of the exemption that deals with labor relations and not those that deal with the minor leaguers, expansion, or other business matters. I knew at some point Staten Island would sue. That part I knew. And I have a feeling Norwich would join them. Didn't know about Tri-City, and of course Salem-Keizer I knew nothing about. But I knew at some point they would be sued. Whether this goes anywhere or not, I have no idea. None. A little bit later, not today, but maybe later in the week, we're going to maybe talk a little about Baseball Hall of Fame. Because Alex Rodriguez is up for the ballot, and it's going to be very interesting to see how he is treated on there. But I thought today was the day to discuss analytics. Because my burr in my saddle about analytics is, as somebody who, by the way, I love looking at stats. But you have to be smart enough to know what's a good stat and what's worthless. Experience tells you that. But analytics and those who are all in on it feel it's the only way to win. And that tells me they have no idea how games are played. There are multiple ways to win. And by the way, analytics is one of them. That's the part that always bothers me about them. What always bothers me about analytics, they think it's the only way to win. Analytics is a way to win. And sometimes during the course of a game, you're looking around, and it's the way to win. And there are other days you look around and go, nope, it's not the right time to do that. You have to have a good sense and feel for the game and how to use analytics as part of it. Back with more in a moment. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Every year can bring new challenges. Your insurance doesn't have to be one of them. Hi, this is Season from Purdy Insurance. 2022 is right around the corner, and now is the perfect time to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you. We have the experience and knowledge to help you protect what matters most. You can contact our office at 570-286-5855 or online at purdyinsurance.com.
Hill in the gun, takes the snap. Steelers send five. The pass is caught at the 10, and Westbrook Akina's knocked down right at the line to make.
They gave it to him, Mark.
Now hang on. The officials will stop the clock and will check out exactly where they spotted the football. They stretch the chain. It may be razor thin short. Let's see. It is awfully close. And they're ruling it short.
That was the Titans Network. That's what I was listening to yesterday as I was driving to Isabella's. And they, and look, I know where the broadcast booth is at Heinz Field, so I know they've got a really lousy angle because I've done two games in Heinz. And They couldn't tell out of the gate whether he had it or not. Then in 1 second they thought he had it. The job they did spotting him, when you look at it later, I couldn't see it till later. Like, what the heck did they spot it there for? Somebody needs to go back to spotting school. That was bad. All right, so. Urban Meyer, of course, to the delight of Matt, no longer coaching. Lou Holtz was 3-10 with the Jets, left, went back to college. Bobby Petrino was 3-10 with the Falcons, left, went back to college. Urban Meyer, 2-11 with the Jacksonville Jaguars, and now who knows? So. Ah, yes. So there you go. It's sorry you missed the party last night.
Yeah, me too.
The lampshade routine with the suit gets, you know, some people say it never gets old. I thought it was old the first time I saw it. Drew and Allie, you know, Gray, Raj, Denise, boys, daughter, awesome. Great seeing Tom Mertz, Steve Engel, everybody last night. Michelle looked radiant. I mean, it was just, you know, wonderful. They had a great time. But again, when he got to dessert eight, well, the food, by the way, at Isabella's was unbelievably good.
Ooh, yeah, they have good food.
But the eighth dessert, I mean, in fact, if you want to balance out, let me tell you, this is a balance. Between the suit and myself, what do you think the average number of desserts was?
Four.
Yes. I had none. He had eight. And he had more. I'm sure he had more after I left. It just was, I mean, it's just embarrassing. I mean, they were bringing desserts to other people. He was taking them off the table and putting it next to him. I mean, the people were like, what? I thought I had a dessert. It was just, I mean, right? And then he's yelling at me as I'm leaving, good luck against Arkansas. I'm like going, oh, I just can't go any further. We had a great time last night. Like I said, the trip back was just wonderful. I mean, like I said, it really was just one great sight after another. It was awesome. Yeah, it really was really nice. But I'm glad you had time with your daughter last night. That's nice.
Yeah, she had an event that I needed to take her to. And
that's so good.
We were in the car, and she did her thing, and then I brought her home. So, and if I remember correctly, well, I know my daughter has a birthday coming up, and I believe your wife shares the same birthday with my daughter next week. So,
yep, 29th. Yep.
So happy birthday to Kathy, and Claire will be 12 next week.
Yeah.
So.
I'm not going to give you the number on. I'm going to be smart about this.
29 and holding?
I'm going to be smart about this. And let's stay out of trouble.
Especially this time of year, Steve.
No. That's any day of the year. It doesn't really matter this time of the year. Okay? Simple as that. Great to have you on board today.
Thank you. Good to be here. Happy holidays to you. And
yep.
Enjoy your time at the bowl game, too.
Yep. Nate Bauer and Neil Coulong tomorrow. We'll talk about the Steelers. We'll talk about Penn State football. So we got a lot going on tomorrow. Should be a fun show. We're going to have shows tomorrow, Wednesday, Thursday. But now this was my call. I'm taking Christmas Eve off. So, and then we'll be back for four shows next week. I'm taking, I'll be in Tampa, but I'm not going to do a show in Tampa. I'm going to be at practice that day, getting ready for the game.